Hello everyone, in the first video of this graph theory playlist, I will go over my solution to the problem named Kefa and Park, which is an easy and introductory problem on depth first search on a tree. I will first explain how DFS on a tree works. So if you already know DFS, you can go straight to the problem. So first let's look at what a tree is. A tree is basically a connected graph with n nodes and n minus 1 edges connecting them. And a rooted tree is a tree in which we fix a particular node to be the root and all edges come downwards from that root. So for example, if we have the tree consisting of 11 nodes and 10 edges joining them and we fix the root to be 1, then this is how the tree will look. So all the edges come downwards from the root. So you can imagine them to be directed edges, and this is how the tree will look like, and the edges will be basically directed because all the edges come downwards from the root of 1. And now let's look at how depth first search works. So first, what is depth first search? Depth first search is an algorithm to visit all the nodes in a tree. And now I'll just give the pseudocode for the algorithm and then explain how it works. So the algorithm is really simple. So basically, when we are calling depth first search on a node U, we visit all the unexplored nodes adjacent to U, and that's how depth first search works. And you could always do something before you visit the adjacent nodes, and then you could do something after you visit the adjacent nodes. So for example, you could print the node U over here before you go to the adjacent nodes, and then you could call depth first search. So if you look at the pseudocode and run it on this graph or on this tree, then the output which you will get is, first you'll visit the node 1, then you'll call DFS to the adjacent nodes of 1. So let's say first DFS comes on 2, then you'll print 2, then you'll call DFS on 5 and 6. So first it will go to 5, so you'll print 5. Then, since 5 has no children or no adjacent nodes which are unexplored, you'll come back to 2. Then you'll call DFS on 6, so it will print 6. Then 6 will call DFS on 11, so it will print 11. And then basically you'll come back to 6 because you have visited the one unexplored node. And then you'll come back to 2. And now, since all the unexplored nodes adjacent to 2 have been visited, we go back to 1. Then similarly, we call DFS on 3, so it will first print 3, then that will go to 7, then that will go to 8, and then we come back to 7 and go to 9, so it will print 9, then we come back to 7 and go to 10, and then basically, since we have done visiting all the nodes over here, we basically go back one at a time. So we go to 7, then we go to 3, then we go to 1. Now the last child of 1 which is left to be visited is 4. So then we print 4. So this is how the DFS traversal will look for this pseudocode of the DFS on this tree. In different problems, you will be required to do different things before and after you visit the nodes. So for example, if you had decided to print the node over here, then the output would actually be very different. So the output would actually be, first you go to 1, but you don't print it. You call DFS on 2, you call DFS on 5. So first it's going to print 5. Then you go back to 2, you go to 6, you go to 11, then it's going to print 11. Then it's going to print 6, then it's going to print 2, because it prints 2 after it has visited all the children or all the unvisited node downwards. Then you go back to 1 and you call DFS on 3, which calls DFS on 7, which calls DFS on 8. So 8 gets visited, and 8 is a node which gets printed first after 2. Then you call, then you go back to 7 and call DFS on 9, and then you go to 10, and then basically you have done visiting all the nodes in 7 subtree. So you basically print out 7, then you print out 3, and then when you come back to 1, you go to 4 and print 4, and then you print 1. So as you can see, these two outputs are very different. So you'll have to think a bit of how you'll do before and after visiting the adjacent nodes. So this is how DFS works. So now how do we actually implement this in code? So some implementation details are that the first thing is, how do we store adjacent nodes to you? That is by using an adjacency list. So an adjacency list is basically a 2D vector, and this is how it will look: vector, vector, int, adjacency list. And this is basically how do we create the edge. So the edge from U to V will be basically look like V push back the V to the adjacency list of U, and we push the adjacency, we push U to the adjacency list of V. So this is how we'll add an edge from U to V. And the next question, which is an implementation detail which may come to your mind, is how do we figure out the unexplored nodes? So how do we find the unexplored nodes adjacent to you? And that is done by using a visited array, which is basically a 1D Boolean vector. And basically we'll initialize vector bool visited of n, and initially all are false. So we'll initialize them to false. Then when we first visit you, we'll basically mark you as visited, and then we'll go to all unvisited nodes. So not visited means V is not visited, basically. So V is not visited or explored, and we'll call DFS on V. So this is basically how we do DFS on a general graph. So actually we are not really using the property of a tree. So so what is the difference between a general graph and a tree? And the main difference, like, which we need to understand for DFS, is that in a tree there's going to be one parent and one child. So let's add that point over here. In a tree, all edges are from a parent to a child, and every child has exactly one parent. This is the key property behind a tree, that every child has only one parent and exactly one parent. And using this key property, we realize that there will be only one node adjacent to you which is visited. So that's the key idea. In a tree, every node U has exactly one parent and some children. So U's parent is the only unvisited, only visited node, and all its children are unvisited. So that's why we actually don't need to maintain the whole visitor array, and we just store the parent. So the code will look something like this. So when we call DFS on the node U and the node's parent, then we go to all nodes V. So V is basically all children plus parent. So that's why if V is not the parent, then we know that V is a child. So V is not a parent, this means that V is a child, which is unexplored, which is unvisited. And that's why we can just call DFS on V. And the other thing is, what do we pass in the DFS function other than V? And the key thing is that U will be the parent for V. If you want to look at an example, then let's say that this is the tree. And let's say we are considering the edge. So let's say that the edge which we are considering is the edge from 3 to 7. So 3 to 7 is the edge. Then what would happen is that U is 3 and V is 7. And hence 3 is the parent of 7. So that explains why when we call DFS recursively on V, we need to pass U as the parent. So U becomes a parent for V. And that's how DFS function works. And this is how we do the implementation of DFS. So as you could see, DFS is actually a recursive method for traversing the nodes in a graph or in a tree. And now an important question which may come to your mind is, how do we actually initially call DFS from the main function? And the thing to realize is that we'll always call DFS on 1, and 1 does not have any parent. So 1 comma no parent, and no parent will we'll represent by minus 1. So since 1 is the root of the tree, there's no edge coming down from some other node. So there's no edge like this from some other node, let's say n. There's no edge like that. And that's why one has no parent. So one is the only node to have no parent. And we basically call DFS 1 comma minus 1 to visit the whole tree. And the reason why we call DFS 1 comma minus 1 is because the root 1 has no parent. That's how the whole DFS function will work. And as you can see, the order in which we visit the nodes, which I told you in the beginning itself, is 1, 2, 5, then 6, 11. Then, so if you want me to illustrate it, then we go from 1 to 2, then to 5. Then we come back to 2, then we go to 6, then to 11. And we come back to 6, come back to 2, come back to 1. Then visit the whole subtree. So this part, I have not defined it earlier, so I'm defining it now. So this is called a subtree, and a subtree is basically the whole whole collection of nodes in which DFS is called. So in this case, you can see that the subtree of 3 is 3, 7, 8, 9 and 10. So from 1 we call DFS to the subtree of 3, and we visit 3, then 7, then 8, then we come back to 7, we visit 9, then we come back to 7 and visit 10. And now we are done visiting the subtree of 7. So now once we finish visiting the subtree of 7, we go back to 3. And we realize that there are no other children. There's only one child of 3, which is 7. And we are done visiting the subtree. So we go back from 3 to 1. And now the last subtree left is that of 4. And we basically visit 4. And we print 4. That's what the output would be if we would print the nodes in the DFS function. And now we know what a tree is, we know how to do DFS on the tree, and we know what a parent is, we know what a child is, and we know what a subtree is. So let's define another term called leaf. So a leaf node has only one parent with zero children. So if you look at this tree and you try to identify the leaf nodes, then the leaf nodes would actually be 5, 11, 8, 9, 10, and 4. And that's what a leaf node is. How do we check if a node is a leaf? In the DFS function, obviously. In the DFS only. And the answer for that would be, we would check how many children does that node have. Leaf has 0 children. And how do we check how many children does that node have? And an easy way to check is to basically, in the code, we would basically do, if V is not the parent of U, then we know that V is a child. And hence, we just increment the number of children which are adjacent to U. So let's also maintain the counter int num children, and basically over here, once we call DFS, we would increment num children. So num children plus plus, and now we know if the number of children is 0, then U is a leaf, otherwise U is not a leaf. So this basically concludes DFS on a tree and how we can actually implement it in code. The implementation is really short, and now let's look at the original problem.